today's topic is charity, and sitting in for Imam Taha, who had to change his plans due to a family obligation, who is sitting in for Imam Nabhan, who's in Egypt. We have Imam Ibrahim Shehata from the Cedar Falls Waterloo area, the Islamic Foundation of Iowa. So we appreciate him sitting in for that representation. Of course, Rabbi Todd Thalbulm from the Temple Judah, and Father Shaheen from St. George Orthodox Church. And I don't know if we want to flip a coin, but I think we decided we would not make the new guy go first. So.
Red hasn't gone first ever.
Oh, really? Oh, you know what? Maybe did his standing go first last time?
No, not first, but he was here last week.
Okay, so we'll go 1, 2, 3. And with that, on the topic of charity, thanks for coming, and enjoy.
Thank you. So some of the conversations before this event today were about the topic, you know, maybe not that exciting or not controversial, maybe, and we'll see, maybe the three faith groups that we have all believe in charity, and I'll support it and I'll encourage it, I don't know. We think maybe they do. So maybe this will be more about finding things in common, which is great, because that's part of our purpose here, to show what we do share in common. So about charity, just a little excursion on the word. This word charity comes from the Latin, and it's a Latin word, caritas, that is in the New Testament, at least in the King James translation, used for agape, which is also translated as love. So the King James does is unique in a way, and that it translates that as charity. So, but I do want to talk about love, and I will use charity, and also use another term kind of interchangeably. So talking about love, talking about charity, first of all, I want to mention a few scriptures here from the New Testament, because charity, love, if we define that as giving to the poor or helping people who can't help themselves or doing for others, loving others, is absolutely, positively crucial to the Christian faith. It's a cornerstone. In fact, it's so crucial, we'll see it a little bit later in the presentation, that we're judged on something like that at the judgment. So, but first of all, I want to talk about the passage from the Gospel of Mark, where Jesus is asked, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus addresses his hearers with two verses, one from Deuteronomy, "Hear, O Israel, hear, the Lord your God is one Lord. You should love the Lord your God with your whole heart, soul, mind, and strength." And Jesus says the second commandment is like it. It's as important. And it's taken from Leviticus, love your neighbor as yourself. Now, in Matthew's version of that, from Matthew chapter 22, I like how it's worded, because Jesus says that, and then he says, you know, love God, love your neighbor. On these two commandments hang or depend the entire law and the prophets. So all the understanding of that scripture is summarized and dependent on love of God and love of your neighbor. So it kind of phrases it nicely. They all depend on that. St. Paul confirms that in his letter to the Galatians. He says, bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ, the law, which is the same as the law of God. So you fulfill that by doing for the other person, by bearing another person's burden. In Luke, we hear the passage of a similar thing. Somebody stands up and asks Jesus a question. This time it's a lawyer, and we're told that he's testing. He's putting Jesus to the test. So he asks him in a different way. You know, it's not what is the most important commandment, but he says, what shall I do, good teacher, to inherit eternal life? What must I do? And Jesus tells him, what do you read in the law? What does the law say? And he mentions love of God and love of neighbor. And then he asks Jesus again for clarification, or possibly to test him, who is my neighbor? So you hear in this gospel a parable that follows, and it's a very specific parable directed to show who the neighbor is, because you know maybe that needs some clarification. So we hear the parable of the Good Samaritan, and in that parable, a man is severely beaten and robbed and left by the side of the road, and various people come by and don't help him, in fact, go to lengths to avoid him, and the person that does stop is a Samaritan, which would be somebody that this man is enemies with. You know, they don't have dealings with each other, Jews and Samaritans. So this Samaritan does help him. He picks him up, he anoints his wounds, he takes him to an inn, he feeds him and makes sure he's properly taken care of, and tells the innkeeper, do whatever you have to do, I'll pay you everything that he owes. So and Jesus asks the question, who was the neighbor then? You know, obviously it's the one who stopped and helped the man, and Jesus says, you go and do the same. So to answer the question, what should I do? It's summarized there. We talk about love. We understand, the Christian understanding, that God loves us, first of all. The evangelist John tells us that God loved us first. So in response to that, our proper response, if we want to accept that love, is to love him back. You know, and that's where the commandment comes in, to love your God with your whole heart, your soul, your mind, and your strength. So we have we're compelled to, if we heed God's call, if we want to be in a covenant with him, we love him back. You know, he loves us first, and we love him back. So the question might come up, you know, to what degree is this true, or how far should we go in this endeavor? Well, it's obviously very important. We even talk about charity or almsgiving or love of the neighbor as being a real cornerstone of the Christian spiritual life, along with prayer and fasting, you know. And I think that we're at fault oftentimes in our teachings because we say something like prayer, fasting, and almsgiving, and it's like the third thing on the list. But it really takes a primacy, and we see that in the Gospel of Matthew, in Jesus' teachings. He, first of all, expects that we do this if we're following him. He says, when you give alms. And in that chapter 6, giving alms comes first. That's the first thing that's talked about, followed by prayer and then fasting. So I would argue that it's utmost important if we love God, if we want to show that we love God. And he says, how do you do it? The same way you do your fasting and your prayers. You don't display it before people, because that has its own reward built in. You might be seen as a good guy or somebody who's you know, showing off, putting it on display. But do it in secret and do it with a sincere heart. So we said that God loves us, and we in turn, if we want to receive his love, we should love him. We love him and we love our neighbor. Love your neighbor as yourself. So when charity is talked about, when love is talked about, they're sometimes put into categories of an action and a virtue. You know, charity as deeds, charitable deeds, and then charity as a virtue. I have a little difficulty talking about charity or love as a virtue. And I just want to put that on hold for a second. Because it's difficult to realize. You know, if we love God, we have to somehow show it. You know, and I think of the words again, the evangelist John. He says, you know, how can you say you love God and then hate your brother who's right next to you, the person right in your midst? You know, you're a liar if you do that. So we would say, kind of to complete that, you can't love God without loving your neighbor. Those two commandments go hand in hand. You know, so I don't want to talk about love of God as a concept, you know, or an ideal or a virtue. Rather, it's something put into action. It's something that's done. And this most important teaching in Matthew chapter 25 is the parable of the Last Judgment. So this is understood as, you know, the end, when God the judge comes, and he comes to judge his people, and he gathers all the nations before him, it says. And what does he look at? What does he ask? What is said? Well, in that chapter, it's talked about, I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was naked and you clothed me. I was in prison and you visited me. I was a stranger and you welcomed me. And to those who responded, Jesus puts on his right hand and he says, come with me and enjoy the kingdom. But the ones who did not, you know, I was in prison and you did not visit me. I was naked and you did not clothe me. I was hungry and you did not feed me, etc. Jesus says, I don't know you. Depart from me. And he's asked, the judge is asked, when did all this happen? You know, when did we see you naked? When did we see you hungry? And Jesus says, whenever you do it to the least person, the least, you do it to me. So we see in that a real concrete command, a direction to tie in love of the neighbor with love of God. You know, if you love God, you do this. And just for clarification, because I know this often comes up and it could be misleading, we don't believe that we're judged on anything we do, you know, having said this. So we are not, we're not judged on anything we do, we're judged on whether or not we love God. And then if we love God, it has to somehow come out. It can't just be an idea. You know, it has to come out in a concrete act. So I just want to say that. And God loves us first. You know, that's what we're shown in the gospel message. God so loves the world, and it's not that he just has strong feelings for us, or it's a virtue that he has, a way he regards us. No, he loves us so much, and then it explains that he gives, that he gave his only son, that all who believe should not perish but have eternal life, from the Gospel of John. So we learn from God that loving is put into action. Just want to now back off of that a little bit, because I want to state that it's not just about the action either. You know, the action in and of itself is not the thing. It's important that we do these things as a proof or as a fulfillment of a love of God, if we have that, that we do put it into action. But the actions themselves aren't sufficient. You know, in other words, if I wrote a check to hurricane victims, that doesn't prove I love God. You know, or if somebody came up to me and asked me for money for coffee and I gave it to this, it doesn't prove I love God. You know, because we can be led into the belief is doing this for other reasons, you know, whatever they may be. We may want to have our name on a list as a donor. We might want to look good in front of people. We might think that we ourselves can save the world and make it a better place. Not that that's bad, you know, to want to make the world a better place. But if that's our reason, you know, sort of taking away from the teaching in the gospel, was it's a proper response to love of God. So it has to be done with the right intention, you know, as a response to the commandment of God. In other words, we're doing it because God says so. And God told us, if you love me, you do this. Now, on the other hand, you might have somebody who is unable to do anything. You know, maybe somebody's disabled or poor. You know, and this person can't give, barely has food for his family, or doesn't have a place to live, you know. How does that person do charitable deeds, you know? Well, then it comes down to, it's not so much the act, but it's the attitude of the heart, the abiding attitude of the heart, which we really can't assess and determine, you know. Only God knows that, and God will judge that. So it's interesting, the play between actions, you know, and intentions. And I know one time I talked about this parable, and it's a possibility to be understood that, you know, we are judged based on the actions we do, but in reality we say, no, we're judged on how much we love God, or whether we love God or not. And then the teaching would be, if you love, then you do this. So charity, obviously, almsgiving, love, you know, to give it a blanket terminology, very, very important, very crucial to the Christian faith, a cornerstone of our spiritual life, something that's encouraged. Churches may do things in a formal way to help people with this, you know, take up collections, might sponsor things in the community. These things are all helpful, but we have to have the right heart. We have to have an open heart that receives people, you know, the stranger, the poor person. And we have to understand that we do it in response to what God tells us. That gospel, I was hungry, I was thirsty, I was naked, we really understand that that Jesus came and he was all those things. You know, he was hungry. He was thirsty on the cross. He was naked in the stable when he was born. You know, he was a stranger. He was in prison. They arrested him and put him on trial. All these things he experiences. So, I mean, it's really connected to our understanding of Jesus as the Son of God and God, and how we do it because he is that. So our love of the neighbor is so closely connected with the love of God. You could almost say they're one and the same, the two great commandments. So thank you for your attention. I'll leave it there.
Would you dear. Reconnect agape? How did you fit that in there?
That's the Greek word that is often translated as, well, not often, I mean, I don't know how often actually, but at least in the King James. There's a famous quote from St. Paul about the three things, and faith, hope, and charity. So agape is love, and it's sometimes called charity.
Is that understood in Christianity generally, do you think, as different from just love one another?
No, I think it's understood as, kind of synonymous. Because whether or not we read the King James, it's had a huge influence on teaching and on our understanding, not just in Christianity, but I think in the language too. So we often think about charity as being love, whether or not it, and it has a different etymology though. It means expensive or precious or high price. That's what the Latin root word means, you know. So, but nowadays we think of it as being the same thing. I don't know, we could probably talk about that in discussions, how we understand that word.
Do you want me to go?
Rabbi Todd.
I'm going to start over here, though, because I think I'm going to use the board for that. That's okay. I don't usually do that. But, I was going to do that, but I'm just going to write. I don't know what the technology here is at Co. So.
Can you still use the mic, Rabbi?
I will talk loud, I promise.
Okay, because we just want
to. I will talk loud now that I'm facing you. Thank you, Fred. First of all, I think we're going to find lots of similarities and commonalities between how we approach charity within Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, although your connection to love is not where Judaism takes it. Not that, you know, it's just not. Although, I like that you started here with Leviticus 19. All right? You started with Leviticus 19, but at the end of where I'm going to start with, you talked about love your neighbor as yourself, right? Love your neighbor. So love your neighbor is actually in Leviticus 19. It's actually verse 18, although I don't often quote chapter and verse. It happens to be one that I know because it's a very, very famous one. All right, but this whole section of Leviticus 19 is actually known as the Holiness Code, according to Judaism. And it's considered the central section of all Torah. In fact, depending upon the way you count Torah being the five books of Moses, Genesis through Deuteronomy, it's the exact middle. Now, it's either the exact middle based on chapters or on lines of Torah or the exact, if you count the numbers of words, it's not always the exact middle of Torah, but you can figure out a way to make it the exact middle of Torah. Torah is about how we are holy. The holiness is about how we emulate God or be like God. And when I start to fill in some of what's in the middle here of the Holiness Code, you will understand how charity, and more importantly in Judaism, tzedakah, helps us be holy, helps us emulate God, helps us be like God, and that's the point of it. But we're going to come back to that. I just wanted to put it up there. Tzedakah. Before we can really, well, in order to talk about charity within Judaism, we have to talk about tzedakah because that's the actual word in Judaism. Charity, it's often translated as charity, but charity doesn't quite cover everything that tzedakah stands for. All right, and I'm going to get to that. In Hebrew, you spell tzedakah tzadi dalet kuf hey. All right, tzadi dalet kuf, that's your tz, your d, and your k, tzedakah. Hebrew is a root-based language, so if you know what your roots are, you can understand the etymology of a word. There's a couple of other words here that are really important and connected. Zedek and Sadiq. You can probably hear that they sound very similar. The place to start, though, is this word Zedek. Zedek is the base word of tzedakah. The word itself either means justice or righteousness, depending upon how you want to translate it. So tzedek is about being just. And in fact, we have a very famous quote in our Torah in Deuteronomy that says, tzedek, tzedek, tirdof, justice, justice shall you pursue. And it puts it in a very positive tense that it's our responsibility, not God's, to pursue justice. Tzadik is a person, a righteous person. In fact, we might call the tzadik the ideal person that we're all trying to become. We want to be righteous individuals. A tzaddik immediately earns his or her share in the world to come. That's how great it is to be considered one of the tzaddik or the tzaddikim. Therefore, tzedakah is not really about love, and the reason that we don't translate it as charity is because charity has this sense of voluntarism. That you volunteer to do charity, that you give a donation out of the goodness of your heart. But in Judaism, charity is not about goodness, it's about righteousness. We have a righteous obligation as individuals to support the needy, to give to those who are in need, and it's not always poor. Although we would translate it typically as poor, tzedakah is not about only giving to the poor. So back to our holiness code. In the Holiness Code, where it talks about emulating God, in the center, it's got two lines about reaping your harvest. All right, and it says specifically, when you reap your vineyard or your orchard or your field, you shall not wholly glean the corners, that they shall be left for the stranger, the orphan, and the widow. And stranger, orphan, and widow is a rubric that shows up constantly in the Torah. And it's more a euphemism for those who are in need, those who tend to not have somebody to look out for them, those who don't have a voice in any given society. The stranger, the orphan, and the widow, so when you reap your harvest, you leave the corners of your field as well as the gleanings of your harvest that fall. You're not allowed to go back and collect everything. This is part of our charitable obligation to others. In fact, there's a discussion in the Talmud about whether or not the owner of the field is even allowed to go through with those in need, helping to get the rest of it. Assuming that he's going to give it all to the needy, he's not even supposed to go that far. Then there's also a sense that people have to do their own, have to be able to look out for themselves. So even though they don't have the ability to grow the food, they don't have the ability to harvest it or sell it, they can go through and collect it for themselves. There's a certain sense of right or righteousness to do that. When we allow people to lift themselves up, it's better for them. And it's better for us. And so there's even a sense that it's not just about our obligations to look out for others, but also to help people feel like they have a place or a role or can even care for themselves in some way. So this is the first thing to understand about the tzedakah within Judaism. A couple of lines from the Talmud that talk about really how significant and important tzedakah is. Rabbi Asi says, tzedakah equals in importance all the other commandments combined. More important than anything else you could do is giving to others, being charitable, engaging in tzedakah. Rabbi Hama, the son of Rabbi Hanina, said, after God shall you walk, which is a quote from Deuteronomy. And he says, but is it possible for someone to walk right beside God? Has it not already been said that God is a devouring fire? Yes, but what the verse means is that you are to follow the ways of God. God clothed the naked, as it's written. God made for Adam and his wife garments of skin and clothed them. So should you clothe the naked. And it is said, God visited the sick. God appeared to them at the terebinths of Mamre. So you should visit the sick. This is part of our tzedakah. It's part of our charitable works. The sick aren't necessarily the needy. They're not necessarily the poor. Sometimes they are. But this is still one of our righteous obligations. God buried the dead. God buried Moses in the valley, right from Deuteronomy. So should you bury the dead. The Holy One comforted mourners. As it came to pass at the death of Abraham that God bestowed blessing upon Isaac his son, so should you comfort mourners. This is also how we go back to this idea that the holiness code is how we act like God. We look for examples of the way that God behaves in the world, and then we try and emulate that in order to be holy, to gain holiness. And tzedakah brings us that. We have been taught by Rabbi Judah, great is tzedakah, for it brings Israel nearer to deliverance. As it is said, keep justice and practice charity, and my deliverance will be near. So this is part of what brings us into the world to come. And at Yom Kippur, as we're making atonement for our sins of any given past year, there's a line that we repeat over and over again. Ut tzedakah, ut tefillah, ut tzedakah, ut tefillah, ut shuvah, tempers judgment. So if we can pray, prayer, repentance, prayer, and charity, so if we repent wholly, we offer our prayers in sincerity, and we do tzedakah, then that is going to bring us into the Book of Life. It means we'll be written into the Book of Life at Yom Kippur. That's the image that we're using at Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur, but it's no different than what's written here in Talmud. This is how important tzedakah is. It can save us, not just the person we're helping, but by doing good work, by doing tzedakah, it actually helps us not only be better people, but it can overcome other faults that we might have. But that's how important tzedakah is. Maimonides. Oh, we're running out of time here. I wanted to go through Maimonides because Maimonides is one of our one of Judaism's most famous commentators. He was a 10th century commentator. He was actually a physicist and a physician and a Talmud scholar, and he wrote numerous works. He's one of our most famous, probably second only to Rashi. And he has a ladder of giving. And he talks us through. Give myself a little room. Maimonides' ladder of giving. He talks about 8 rungs of giving that could happen. Maimonides. All right, 1, 2. The bottom one is the lowest rung, right, of course. This is giving unwillingly. All right? This is the lowest rung. It's still tzedakah. You're still giving. It's still a righteous obligation. You're just doing it for the wrong reasons, maybe. You're not doing it out of the goodness of your heart, but you're still giving, so it counts as tzedakah. It's still important. It's maybe not as great as other forms of tzedakah, but more important that you give even if it's unwilling. All right? The second one is to give willingly, but inadequately. Now, obviously God is the one who determines whether or not it's adequate, but the idea here is you're giving, you're supposed to be giving, but you're not giving as much as maybe you should. There's actually a 10%, this tithe that the Christians have, starts within Judaism here, the 10% tithe, that this is what we're expected to give to charity. 10% of what we earn or make or have, we should be willing to give. And in fact, Judaism says, everyone, whether you're one of the people that's always giving or you're one of the people that's always receiving, everybody's expected to give. Even the needy, when they get charity or tzedakah from others, are expected to turn around and give some. Not a lot, 10%. But this is also part of being part of the world, that we have this obligation, and everybody has this obligation, and you won't be as good a person if you can't engage in it. So even those who are needy are expected. Of course, the Talmud also says that there's an upper limit. It actually puts an upper limit at 20%. Even the most wealthy, even if you can give more, there seems to be an understanding within the Talmud that we are not to put ourselves in a position where we might become destitute or needy, that we have to be looking out for ourselves. Even as much as we look out for others, we also need to be taking care of ourselves as we can. We should never put ourselves in a position if we can help it, where we're going to be on the other end. And so Talmud actually puts an upper limit. But the seventh rung here, right, the second to lowest rung is to give, but not to give as much as you should. The sixth one is to give adequately, but only after someone asked. So you give what's needed, but somebody has to come ask you for it. Right? You still get a little bit of a, there's kudos to you, you're giving. I mean, you're even giving what you should or as much as somebody needs, but you're making people ask you for it. The next one up is giving before being asked. Right? You understand that it's your job, your obligation, you're going to give. And so you're giving even before people ask you, you're giving to whatever charity or wherever you think it's important or needed. The next one is giving publicly to a known recipient. So you know somebody who's in need and you go out and give it to them, you make sort of a show of it. You're still giving. That person is being helped. It's a good thing. However, it's not the best way to do it. Right? That there's a sense of maybe shame for the person who's receiving, and that you're not taking that into account, according to Maimonides and according to other rabbis. So the next one is anonymous. You don't do it in public, but you give it anonymously so that you don't know, so that the person who's getting the money doesn't know. This isn't from you, it's anonymous to who's receiving it. Or you might know who you're giving the money to, and in fact, on this rung you do. This is public, everybody knows. You give, somebody receives, both parties know who's giving the money and who's receiving. The next step is for you to give money through the rabbi, which has happened. I've had people give me money and say, I know that these people are in need. Can you make sure it gets to them for this celebration or this party or this bar mitzvah or for food this week, whatever it happens to be, all right? So it's done anonymously to the person who receives it. So that means the person giving isn't expecting some kind of reward. That shows a higher level of giving, but it's still not as great as it could be. So the next one is anonymous on both sides, right? You give, they receive. You don't know who's getting the money that you're giving. They don't know who's helping them. Nobody's looking for a reward here. You're just trying to do the best work that you can and to help people. That's giving anonymously. But in actuality, the highest rung is to help someone become self-sufficient. Right? This is the old adage, if you give someone a fish, they eat for a day. If you teach someone to fish, they eat for a lifetime. The best possible life, best possible giving tzedakah that can be done, according to Maimonides, is something that helps others become self-sufficient. So this might not be money. This might be teaching somebody a trade or helping get them to school or doing something else for them. It's not always money. And in fact, one of the prayers that we pray every day, every morning in a prayer service in Judaism, we pray this prayer called Elu Divarim. These are the things that are limitless, of which a person enjoys the fruit in this world, but the real principle remains in the world to come. They are, and these are the deeds that one does in this life that accords them this sense of tzedakah. Honoring one's father and mother, engaging in deeds of compassion, arriving early for study morning and evening, dealing graciously with guests, visiting the sick, providing for the wedding couple, which really means making sure that a couple can have a celebratory wedding, accompanying the dead for burial, being devoted in prayer, and making peace among peoples. That not all of the tzedakah we do is monetary, which is why I don't like to use the word charity either. Although charity is not always just monetary, you can do charity in a lot of other ways. In English, it has a connotation of making a monetary donation. In Judaism, it can be monetary, it doesn't necessarily have to be monetary. So you give, we give in lots and lots of different ways, but it is one of the central, really the central motifs within Judaism. This idea that we should be pursuing justice, we should be looking out for the stranger, the widow, and the orphan, and that tzedakah, as Jews do tzedakah, is about righteousness and justice. It's not about volunteerism. We have an obligation to it. Yeah, Linda.
Where does that come from?
Where does what?
To help someone become self-sufficient.
Maimonides, eight levels of giving.
Yeah, but where?
Maimonides,
where before that?
Oh, it's in his Mishnah Torah. The day levels giving found in Maimonides' Mishnah Torah, which is it's kind of like a tractate. The Talmud is supposed to teach us how to live a Jewish life based on the Torah. And then there used to be comments on the commentary on the commentary on the commentary. Well, at some point in the 10th century, after 1,000 years, Maimonides felt like the commentary and the commentary and the commentary was becoming so confusing he would start from scratch. And so the Mishnah Torah is a scratch version of the Talmud that's supposed to help us with the real details for a 10th century Jew, right? We're now another 1,000 years later, doesn't quite fit, and there's been other books that have been written, but this was one of the major works at one point in Judaism. And in the Mishnah Torah are Maimonides' 8 levels of giving, and the highest one, as he actually says it, is giving an interest-free loan to a person in need, forming a partnership with a person in need, giving a grant to a person in need, finding a job for a person in need, so long as the loan, grant, partnership, or job results in the person no longer living or relying upon others. I mean, he gives a big, long explanation for helping someone be self-sufficient. But that's where it comes from. Other questions? Well, we'll do other questions later. I think that that's probably as much as you... Tzedakah is a huge word in Judaism. We could spend a semester trying to really unpack everything that it means in the way that we behave. But the biggest piece of it is that this is about righteousness and it's our obligation. It's not about just doing something nice. All right, we'll move on. Thank you.
My dear brothers and sisters, I welcome you, and really I got quite a bit of education. It's fun to have actually religious leaders actually talking, you know, and sharing this with the people. It's fun more actually to have somebody like myself to be, you know, called an imam, as well as I used to be a professor. So I can be maybe 1 and 20 minutes for my, cheering. actually, you know, it's very interesting when you look at, I was preparing too much stuff actually to share, but I will pick up from our brother, the minister and the rabbi. Wendy, we were actually sharing with you about loving God from the charity point, as well as the tzedakah. One of the things that you might not have caught, like somebody like myself, tzedakah. Is that the actual word?
Tzedakah, yeah.
How about tzedakah?
I'm sure, the Arabic, I'm sure, is very similar.
It's the same exact word.
Yeah, I'm not surprised.
The same exact word. Tzedakah or tzedakah. And in Islam, tzedakah is being taken in two different directions. One is a mandatory giving, and the other one is a voluntarily giving. Okay? The mandatory giving is coming from the 5 pillars of Islam. You cannot be a Muslim without 5 pillars. Okay? And the third or the fourth, sometime, you know, they can, in some of the sayings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, sometimes they say the charity, or it is not actually charity, they call it zakah. So we are talking about love God, and we are talking about helping others and the holiness. In Islam, the word zakah means purification. Okay, so you are loving God, you are trying to be a holy person, but you are trying to prove to yourself that you are purified. And the purification here has something of more constructive to the whole entire community. It's not only for the widows, or the poor, or the needy, or those, you know, I'm seeing 8 categories for people giving. We have 8 categories for people taking. 8 categories for people taking. Who should be taking, you know, the sadaqah, or the zakah, or the cleanliness of the person? Cleanliness, it's cleanliness. Meaning, I cannot become a Muslim. Or, as a matter of fact, if I am a Muslim and I am living in an Islamic country that ruled by Muslim regime and a leader, he is capable of fighting me to get the right from me and giving it to the 8 categories. Because if I don't do that, my heart is not clean, my life is not clean, I'm stingy, I'm a dangerous person against the whole entire, not just the country, the whole entire universe. Okay? So to that extent, you know, it's a purification. And it is not just a purification from the aspect that I'm going to pay So I can get only the reward, but I'm also, as I'm getting the reward, I can get punished. So it is, you know, a boundary for everybody to look at. I fulfilled everything in my family, and I have taken all what is necessary for the life of my family. And I reach it to the level where I can start giving. And that level is not up to me. It is well determined Islamically. It's well structured. And at that point, I should be giving to anybody, and everybody is in need under these eight categories. Okay? That helps, you know, the human who is giving, of I'm not going to be empuzzling you or, you know, taking advantage of you or actually being transgressing some of the people that I'm a physician, I can charge anybody whatever I like. I cannot do that and play, you know, this game knowing that I have to purify myself. So I have to be a community member that can reflect not only in his life, because this life is not the eternal life for us, as a Muslim perspective. This life is for all of us to live together, knowing one another the best, helping one another the best, and getting the reward in this life and in the hereafter. This is a big, you know, idea, you know, and principles in Islam. One of the amazing things that, as I was searching about this topic, I found out, do you know, in 2011, how much did we have in charity in the United States?
Always.
Just in the United States. $300 billion. Okay? The maximum of it was paid in the last few weeks before the end of the year. We are talking about holiness. Okay, we are talking about watching ourselves. We are talking about, oh, Uncle Sam is going to take our money, so let's, you know, pay some. 35% of it is being given to religious organizations, and 14% for education. So half of the money that is being collected goes only to religious organizations and education. About 26% is being given to the people who are working in human services, serving humans, but not necessarily actually. This is the staff, this is the, you know, the money. You know, you give me $1,000, which is actually, you know, on an average $1,000 a year. Per normal living American. Now, and I'm, you know, I have, I don't know, we can discuss this more, you know, in our discussions, but imagine right now, as we are in the election, two candidates, one is saying, you know, I'm supporting the rich, and one is supporting the middle class families. And both of them, they are forgetting about the poor people. Maybe we need a third party for our poor people. Okay? 82 times in the Holy Quran, 82 times, it is mentioned the word zakah or sadaqah, connected to the prayers. So you cannot pray without giving the zakah to purify yourself. The concept of the purification in Islam, while we are, even the five pillars, it all, or all of them, they are dealing with purification. While I'm giving it to any poor person, publicly or secretly, I'm giving it in the sake of Allah and Allah alone. Okay? This is a purification of my intention that we just talked about. Okay? Second, while I'm praying, I'm actually cleaning my clothes, cleaning my heart, and cleaning the place where I'm going to be praying. While I'm fasting, I'm cleaning all myself to say I am in control of my life, not the life is in control of me. I can have every single thing allowed or prohibited, but I'm in control of everything. So a purification, bringing us closer to God, loving God. Okay? Not only that, But we are looking with the zakah as the purification in our wealth and our health and everything else. Okay? So there is, you know, a punishment that somebody can policing and taking the money from me out of, you know, one of these eight categories. You know, I'm giving it unwillingly. No, I have to give it willingly. Because if I give it while people are, the people who are in power, and they are empowered to distribute the wealth on the people, I'm not going to get any reward from God for it. Because it was taking, you know, I'm stingy, I'm attached to this life. Okay? So from this concept, you know, we are talking about give willingly. And if, and in Islam also, you know, giving is not like in Judaism and Christianity, but more, you know, I would say in Islam, it is more to closer to Judaism, you know, from Prophet Ibrahim, and even from Adam, from the beginning. You know, when you look at the voluntarily giving, the children of Adam, you know, when both of them, they give, you know, a gift to God, but one of them give the best, and one didn't. Okay? You know, and what happened? The one that was pushed to give and give the worst than the other one that he gave voluntarily with love to God. Okay? He had the hatred, you know, against his own brother. So from this aspect, you know, Islamically speaking, when I am reaching to the point that I have enough now and I'm self-satisfied with me, my family, and everybody around me that I'm responsible for. And I reach to that limit and I say, this is about, let's say, nowadays it's closer about $3,000. If I have a $3,000 and I don't need it at this moment, I start actually waiting for one calendar year. And this amount should not be reduced by any means throughout this year. After this amount, when it is a $3,000 and gets up, than the $3,000. If it is $100,000, I take away 2.5% and give it in the sake of Allah to anybody is in need out of these eight categories. If I don't know who to give, I can give it to some people, like, you know, in the example of the synagogue, rabbis or ministers or sheikh or whomever else. The best is for me to look for my brothers and sisters living around me. Not brother and sister, by the way, you know, Islamically speaking, only for the Muslims, but it can reach to anybody and everybody. To the point that when, and there is a concept in Islam for a Muslim, you know, country, has a treasury house. And all the money would be put in this treasury house. And everybody needy or need to be, you know, self sustained will get out of this, and whatever is in excess of this or more than what they deserve will go to other categories, to the point that you can provide from the zakah for the bird food. And it did happen. Okay, so it actually covers anybody and everybody living under this society. It's what we call it, like, you know, the interest, you know, in Judaism is prohibited. Same thing in Islam, you know, looking for your brother, instead of putting it in a bank, put in the bank of your eternal life, and we give it to our brothers. He's a student, he can be, you know, after graduation, can be another member of the community that will lift people up, okay? You can put it to the limit of somebody would like to get married, but he doesn't have the means to get married. Somebody has a business and he would like to put this in the business. Somebody that he can, or they can, or she can, or whatever can. One time, to enhance, you know, the point of the rabbi, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, used to come people to him and ask him anything and everything. And he gives. But as he is giving, He's looking at the person. How can we help this person the best? So a huge guy coming to him and saying, give me from what Allah has given you. He said, do you have anything at home? He said, yes. I just have a rug and I have a cup. That's all that I have. He said, bring them over. He brought them and asked the companions, and here he made an auction. Who would like to buy this? They looked at it, it doesn't worth anything. One person said, I'll give just $1 as an example. You know, he said, I would like to get more. So another person said, okay, I see that you want something. How about I give you two? He said, okay, take them. And he gave these two, you know, dollars or two dirhams, you know, in this time. He gave it to that man that he was asking him. And he said, buy with one food for you and your family, and bring me an axe, and I'll make you axe that you can cut trees with it. And he brought these, and he told him, don't show me your face for 2 weeks. Work and come back. After 2 weeks, he came, and he made quite a bit of money. He said, oh, Prophet of Allah, I made quite a bit of good money. See how much did I get? He said, isn't that better for you than asking people? Sustenance. Okay? There is, and this is, you know, also in Islam, many Muslims, misconceptually, always, when they give example about zakat, they talk about the money. No. We are here in Iowa, we are farmers. Majority of it. Can we call ourselves that? Okay. At the time of harvesting, you know, if you don't use John Deere equipment, and you don't use all of the sophisticated equipment, and you spend quite a bit of money on it, if God's nature is bringing you everything, all the water is available, and people are helping you the best, and you don't need any spending extra, and so on, this equipment, at the time of harvesting, you give one-tenth of what has been harvested to you back to your community. If you have bought, you know, some of this equipment and use some of this technology, you give 5%. How about animals? Yes, animals is the same thing. If you have different categories of animals, this is how, you know, when you hear, by the way, a Muslim says, you know, I'm living Islam. It is a true 24/7 because it is well structured in terms of what to do and what not to do. You know, sometime, you know, if it is left up to us, I can be very good and give too much. But somebody else, or I may be not, you know, that good of a person. Or I'm confused, I don't know what to give. So I don't know how much I should be. This is well explained, okay, in this category. If you are, you know, having a mine, if you are having, you know, a farmer, if you are raising, you know, cattle, and whatever it is, there is a category. You know, and if you are a business person, I don't tell you, you do that. Is that enough of a time, or?
You still have 5 minutes.
Okay. One of the things that giving is not only just for men. Okay, the prophet's wives, one of them, one time, they used to give. You know, all of them, they used. I'll give two quick examples about the Prophet, one time what he did, and another time with his wife. The Prophet's wife, one time, as she was, you know, before giving out something in the sake of Allah, she got the perfume and she put it, you know, put on this money or food or whatever she is giving, she put this in a perfume. He said, why are you doing that? Giving money and you are putting perfume? She said, yes. Before I give these to the person, I'm not giving it to the person, I'm giving it to Allah. It is falling in the hands of God. The love, the kindness, you know, the concept, the consciousness. Okay? Sadaqah, as the rabbi said, by the way, you know, he taught us it means
righteousness.
Sadaqah, the root of it, sadaqah, or Siddiq, okay? Truthfulness. You are a true human on this earth that you have a good relationship with God. This is also, you know, you can see it can complement one another and integrate, you know, to be righteous, to be truthful, to be cleaned, purified, okay? Prophet Muhammad one time, you know, and I may be just ending with this, although I didn't actually go through what I prepared, but we may be just actually when we have the time we can talk about it. One time Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, had a lamb slaughtered and told his family, you know, just distribute it. And he came back and he said, what is left in the lamb? He said, we have given everything, except what is left is the shoulder of the lamb. Because we know that you like, you know, this piece. He said, what is really was kept is everything. But what is not being used is the shoulder. Meaning, all what you have given, this is really what is staying in the hands of Allah. He is going to be rewarding it for you, you know, and He is going to be multiplying this. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us, God Almighty is telling us in these verses, you know, glad tidings as well as warnings. Okay? For those who are giving, they will be multiplied in the giving in this life and in the hereafter. And there is 8 gates to the paradise. After the day of judgment, you know, when the people are accounted for their deeds, there is one of these gates, it is only for those who are giving. None will get into it except those who are giving. On the other side, if you don't give, and you love gold, you love money, you love wealth, and you are keeping it sitting in this life because you don't want to, you know, look for your neighbors, look for the widows, look for the poor, look for the needy, look, you know, for whatever categories, the orphans and what have you, this will come into your neck, holding you in the day of judgment in the hellfire. So it's not, you know, something, you know, for Muslims, when I'm giving, I'm not just giving so I can claim it in my tax return with Uncle Sam. Okay? But I am giving it because it is my obligation. Because I love God. Because I have to actually, you know, look for my neighbors. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he said, he is not among us. He is not among us. He's not a Muslim. This person who stays at night fully stomach, and his neighbor is hungry. To that extent, you know, and there are tons of things, you know, forgive me of not sharing, you know, as many, but I would like, you know, to be very careful with the love for my brothers, that they had the same exact amount of time, so I have to actually at least stop it and adhere, and then, you know, during the discussions we can get more. Thank you.
Questions and answers, Dr. Al.
I like very much the distinction that Rabbi Todd drew between charity on one hand and righteousness and justice on the other. And it seems to me I have a couple of problems with not just the word charity, but the concept of charity as we often carry it out. One is a story from a few years ago. My wife's oncologist called about half a dozen of his patients and their spouses 10 years ago and asked if we would be willing to start a foundation whose purpose would be to provide grants to people who've exhausted all of their means of payment for the prescription drugs that they need for their cancer treatment. That foundation's been in operation now for nearly 11 years, and our maximum grant is $500. So I was standing by the loading dock down by the co-union a couple of years ago, waiting for the food that we were going to use for a pancake benefit breakfast to raise money for the foundation. And the president of Co., Jim Pfeiffer, who's a good friend, came by and asked what I was waiting there for, and I explained. And he said, not in a cynical way, that's very sweet that you're doing that, and I guess it's better than nothing, but it doesn't come close to being adequate. That is, it's a drop in the bucket compared to a our lack of a decent program of national health insurance. And if you look at food or any other major commodity, private charity is pathetically inadequate. I mean, if all state and federal food programs were to go out of business tomorrow, every faith community in the country would have to come up with over $1 million to take up the slack. So I guess one of my quarrels with the concept of charity, as it's often thought of, is that it's sometimes seen, I think, as a substitute for rather than a supplement to justice. I think it's very nice we have a community health tree clinic here in town, but again, there are all sorts of problems with it, like continuity of seeing the same doctor from one visit to another. So I think it's very important we not delude ourselves that charity is anything close to an adequate strategy, and I appreciate that some of you made that point. The other point about charity, I think, is that it's often seen, justifiably, as demeaning to the dignity of the recipient, and it's very nice if people can achieve self-sufficiency, but that's not always possible. One of my favorite stories is of after Medicare had been passed by both the House and the Senate in 1965, and President Johnson was about to sign it, he, in a very gracious, magnanimous gesture, flew to Independence, Missouri, so that former President Harry Truman, who'd been trying to get a program of national health insurance passed for the previous 20 years, could be with him and a part of the signing. And Truman gave a very moving speech, in his usual feisty give him hell way, said, "We seniors, we elderly, don't want charity. We want justice in something like a Medicare program." So I think charity is a good thing so long as it's not seen as anything close to a substitute for adequate public programs.
Can I comment on this? How many of us know, you know, in Iowa, how many hospitals or who established our hospitals here in Iowa? Mm-hmm. They are what? Majority of the of them, they are religiously based hospitals. Where is this concept of it? Meaning?
That was the original impetus, but they're secular now.
That's and this is one of the things, you know, and I may get agreement not just among three of us, but among all of us. Not every Jew is really a Jewish, you know, follower, or any Christian is really a Christ follower, or any Muslim is Islam coded or follower. You know, we start out very good and say conceptually this is well, you know, and this is the biggest hospitals in the nation. They are religiously rated and backed and established by these religious organizations from donors. Now, you know, they may be providing you with the health insurance capabilities, but they will get every single penny out of you later on. And not many of them, they will be actually supporting, you know, the concept of sadaqah or charity.
I'd like to take us out of some of the clouds of theology for just a few minutes and ask a very practical question, or maybe a series. Imam, you actually got into this quite a bit. We talk about the tithe or the tenth, almsgiving, the 2.5 of the pillar of Islam. Okay, for the layperson, what does that mean? 10% of what? 10% of income? 10% of stock portfolio? You know, this is where it gets very difficult, I know, but I want to know what you three can present, for instance, to your congregations if they ask you what this means.
Right. So within Judaism, the 10% starts out as related to your harvest, right? So if we're talking about ancient Judaism, it's an agricultural community. They either have fields or orchards or some cattle or some sort of animals, and 10% would be of any given harvest or any given annual cycle, right? Whenever you were going on, there were three pilgrimages to Jerusalem, and it was related to whether it was, you know, the agricultural time or it was the calving time or, you know, it was picking trees. 10% of what you gleaned or 10% of the calves that were born,
okay,
right? Because you wouldn't go from the other stock, those are as they were born, new ones to you, right? 10% of the stock was meant to be given over to the temple at the time, which would have been the charitable institution.
Right, they were distributed.
Right, that was distributed in that way. So in general terms, 10% would be income, right? That was their livelihood, that was what they made. So as we moved away from agrarian society into more of a monetary society, at least on the easy level is to say, it's 10% of your income in any given year, right? You know, and then you get, is it net or gross? Not
right.
getting it in. 10%
right.
of your income,
yeah.
right? But it's not always money, as I said. So
right.
what if you decided that you were going to give 4 hours of your 40-hour work week? Right? You're earning, you're working 40 hours, you're earning a certain amount of money, so 4 hours a week you're going to give over and above to charity as part of your job, then that might count as your charity, right? Because it doesn't have to be money. So there's a lot of leeway in the way that you would work it out in your own heart and what you're doing. And certainly, I, as the rabbi, or any one of the religious leaders in this room, or anyone, we're not the ones checking whether or not you're giving
right.
your obligation. That comes down to between you and God in the end, that God's the one who knows whether you do what you should be doing, right? Not us. So, I mean, in general terms, it's 10 annual income, 10% of what you make, or 10% of your working life.
Okay.
So if you're a lawyer, you can give 4 hours of legal fees pro bono over and above what you're
okay.
doing, and every week, great. That, so what?
Mm-hmm.
Fair?
I would agree with that. It's certainly, from our perspective, not strictly income-based. We do talk about a tithe. I'm coming from an Antiochian Orthodox Christian perspective. A lot of Antiochian churches, communities, people do not tithe. They don't give anywhere near 10% of their income. Based on kind of an old world understanding of how to support the church through various other gifts and committing your time and your talent as well as your treasure. So, but strictly speaking, our church does tithe to the archdiocese. A strict 10% of our operating budget goes back to them. So we've sort of set that course in motion and suggest to people 10%. People give what they want,
it doesn't
give
have
what
to,
they can from their heart.
It doesn't have to go to the church or the synagogue anymore, right? Charitable,
right.
all kinds of charitable organizations.
Right. Sure.
So when we say 10% of your income, you're not necessarily giving 10% directly to the synagogue,
right?
right? You know, we have a dues structure, you have a collection plate or whatever that people give, but I would expect, you know, a certain percentage goes to their church or their synagogue or their mosque, and a certain percent goes to Habitat for Humanity
right.
or some other charity that's
right.
out there that they feel strongly being, you
sure.
know, whatever it is. So.
We say giving it to God, and we stress the first fruits of your harvest, not the leftovers.
Right.
The top
10%.
From the Islamic perspective, you know, as I mentioned, I need to say, you know, be sufficient for my family, provider for the family.
Okay.
Okay. Because I don't want to ask you. So, you know, whatever is extra, and I'm the one
okay.
between me and God who is deciding this is the extra. You know, and I'm not tricking anybody except myself
right.
if I just pay that bill, okay? So from that aspect, I said, yeah, I'm satisfied. You know, I'm taking care of business. This is, you know, the level that I reach it right now, and this is equivalent to the amount which is called nisab. Nisab means the limit.
Okay.
I reach it to that limit, and the money is staying. I don't need it. It's staying for a whole entire, you know, lunar calendar. Okay, and it is, you know, in access to this amount, never went down, okay? At that point, you know, that amount, it is not only this amount, the limit, it is even beyond that. So I'm gonna give the 2.5%. Now, this is what is mandatory. You know, the same example, you know, that the Rabbi mentioned about the harvesting, you know, that doesn't have anything to do with my income. It is the time that I'm harvesting it, I'm taking 10% out of it right at the moment. What to Hasali, what to, in the verse, it says, give this amount at the time of harvesting. Okay, so I'm just excluding this and start distributing it, you know. Now, what does the community need? I may be giving, you know, the 2.5%, but I have too many friends, too many people, too many families, too many, you know, needy that they really need that. That's what is called sadaqah, the voluntary one. And the voluntarily one can be way beyond that. I just give you a very funny example. When I went to with my accountant, you know, to do the taxes, and as she was looking at it, and she said, "Are you Christian or a, you know, a Jew?" What? Why? She said, "You look like, you know, in the category of Christian and Jew."
Because of your charitable donations. They used to say, and it hasn't, knock on wood or whatever, thank God I haven't been audited, but they used to say that rabbis and priests get audited way more often because our charitable donations tend to be way out of whack with our incomes.
You know, we had the situation, a colleague of mine, not a cleric of any sort, clergy person, she and her husband were audited several times because they gave actually more than 10%.
And this is exactly what, by the way, what happened. You know, they audited me, you know, and as a matter of fact, when they audited, they found, you know, while I'm detailing it, you know, I found out, or they found out, that I paid even more, you know, to play it conservatively. So this is a misconception in general, you know, that a community, you know, and we are not watching, you know, but we are helping the community members, you know, to make 100% sure. This is, you know, between you and God, and it's not just between you and God. You look at New York, you know, just in the flooding, you know, people do take the chance and go and, you know, intrude some of the businesses and steal things. Why is this happening? Because people starting, you know, not applying the social, you know, system that I care for him. He's my neighbor, he's my friend, he's, you know, my classmate, and so forth.
I think that idea just of the tzedakah is that it's all year round, and you don't need to start the meter running to see how much you've actually given.
Yeah.
It's in everything you do, whether it's a
right.
dollar here or an act there,
right.
But the mandatory bit, the 2.5, is maybe where someone might say, oh, they say 10%, 2.5 for Islam, but that then, again, is based on savings, anything above that limit, and it's what you saved over the course of a year, and 2.5% of what you saved over that year is what is the mandatory amount to give at a particular annual time of Eid al-Fitr at the end of Ramadan, which is the mandatory time to then shell
that's
that out.
Right, yeah.
But otherwise, it's all year round. And if I'm inaccurate, please correct me on something.
Yet even, you know, with what you just mentioned, you know, I'm saying this is my reaching point of that limit. My reaching point may be different than his, different than his, different than the whole entire community. We are reaching at level that all year round people are giving mandatory as well as voluntarily.
Okay.
And there are not just only these 2.5%. You mentioned actually about the Zakat al-Fitr, you know, during the fasting, you know, all the month fasting, you know, deals that everybody try to get the reward of it is not going to be accepted without actually giving additional charity, you know, that goes back. Not only that, but the sacrifice feast, you know, to commemorate Abraham's, you know, and children and the pilgrimage as well. If I'm capable, I slaughter a lamb at least, you know, and I distribute it back. One third I enjoy it with my family, one third with my friends, and one third for the poor and needy people in the community. So it's all year around is, you know, you are awake the whole entire year. You are not only awake in the last few weeks of the...
Start back there and we'll come up timer.
Now, it seems to me something I haven't heard mentioned yet is that the issue of charity is simultaneously an economic issue in the broad sense, and a political issue. And I thought the rabbi reminded me of something when you mentioned about, you know, give a person a fish.
Right.
And the third part of that, it seems to me, is that you need to provide a place for the person to fish. Once you've taught them to fish, then you need to, and, you know, we lapse easily into this ideology of individualism when it comes to charity and giving and you know, what's my responsibility, instead of and I heard more from the rabbi and from the imam about a more communal sense or corporate sense of giving than I did from Pastor Shaheen. It seems to me that we don't have a corporate sense of what we are obliged to our neighbor for. You know, justice is a foreign concept to us, except in a legalistic way. We don't think of justice economically or politically. We just think in terms of my rights or our rights. And I wonder, you know, like our own governor said, you know, the state doesn't have any business feeding people. That's up to charities.
Charities
so,
can't feed everybody.
So what are our political responsibilities and what are our economic responsibilities in terms of our community of Cedar Rapids, of the state of Iowa, of our country, in terms of dealing with people? You know, capitalism tolerates some unemployment. We think if we've got 4 or 5% unemployment, we're in tall cotton. That's how many million people out of work. And so what's our responsibility to those people if we can't provide them a place to fish?
I don't know, it's a great question. And when you're using a place to fish, you're talking about really a job, right? You train somebody in some sort of skill, whether it's fishing or it's, you know, working in a machinery or, you know, working at McDonald's or whatever it is that you're giving them a way to earn money, but then you also have to provide them with a job so they can make that money. But I think on some level, we're getting outside of what our individual capabilities are. And I love the bumper sticker that says, think globally but act locally, right? That there's only so much that we as individuals can do. So when we talk about tzedakah, the first thing, our charity, and the first level is an individual level. What can we as an individual, what's my individual obligation to my neighbor, to my community, to my family? That was where I started in with this idea of charity. There is a larger sense that the community itself is supposed to be taking in the aggregate, all of this charitable giving that's happening, to make sure that it's not only getting to the right place, but we built the kind of political structure that would allow it to actually help people who are in need, and it's not just, you know, putting a drop of water in a bucket that's never getting full, right? The political speech, changing the political landscape of an environment is not necessarily tzedakah. That's work, that's politics, that's government. That's not the idea of giving charity or being charitable to others. And so I don't know what the right answer is. I think that we take the values that each of our religions are teaching us to try and create a political climate that's, you know, meeting the needs of what we hope to be meeting, what our communities want to meet. But I think that's separate from a charitable obligation.
Yeah, I don't know how to answer that either. But I would
agree.
The individual and, you know, look at the level of what can I do to make a difference? What can I do? Always try when you can. You know, we may feel powerless, but certainly when you can help somebody, you can make a difference. You should.
I have a couple of points, by the way. Do we know that we have 1.5 million nonprofit organizations here in the United States? One per 20 people living in the United States, we have these. And all these 1.5 million, they are collecting $300 billion business.
Which I believe is now more money than the rest of the world gives charitably combined. So $300 billion in the United States, it's a huge number.
It may be actually more than, you know, African budget. Okay? But here is the catch. There is something wrong when we have 1.5 million nonprofit organizations in itself, and we have 40 million people under the poverty line.
Yeah.
Number one. Number two, politically, you know, we are talking about, and I really admire Cedar Rapids. Although Cedar Rapids is not as mature as we would like to be in terms of political, you know, activism, but it is better, or I can say the best, I would say, in Iowa. Okay? In cornering and challenging the political candidates. I know for sure everybody talked about Obama, whether he was a Muslim or is not.
Right.
Or Romney, you know, whether, you know, his denomination is going to affect us or not. Okay? And I know for sure that they love and they must secure the backing of religious organizations. True statement or not? So how are we as even we can't, as, you know, for me and the rabbi and the father, you know, we don't have the tons of the time. We are not 24/7, you know, working, and even if we do that, our means may not be encompassing everything. But it is, as a whole entire community, we can influence something. Okay? You don't have to declare whether you are Republicans or Democrats to actually pressure them. Okay? You know, so there is a side of it that we need to be more active in making 100% sure. The concept of the IRS, this is the same concept Islamically that I said about the treasury house. Okay? The treasury house for the Muslim, at the time that one ruler, he actually gave up his real wealth before he ruled. And within 29 months, it was Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, within 29 months only, and that was a dynasty where Muslims were, you know, the leading the whole entire universe. But because the ruler was really, really for the people, and he went down to the people, and he made his own ruling system to the people, the treasury house covered not just, you know, paving the roads, not Muslims or non-Muslims throughout the whole entire, you know, dynasty where he was ruling, but even feeding the birds. So I think, you know, the message here is the money that he's putting, you know, in the IRS or collected, is this is being used back to the needy people? That's a major question. Second, our own politicians, they don't pay, majority of them, and we are discovering this, both coins, the faces of the coin, Republican or Democrat, majority of them, they don't pay taxes until they are going to be nominated for office. Are we doing something about it? It's going to end with our life. And until, and this is a major point, Allah, Almighty Allah, God, has told us something. Allah will never change the people until the people change in themselves.
God helps those who help themselves, right? That's exactly common as well.
That's exactly
right.
Rabbi Todd, I found it curious. I like that list. Why do you think giving publicly is a notch above, is ranked a notch above giving before we pass?
It's a great question.
Because I would think that there's a pitfall in there.
A little bit. Yeah, the idea is that you're giving after being asked. So giving after being asked, obviously, is a lower rung because you had to be asked.
Sure.
Before being asked, you could be giving publicly or not publicly, right? That there's just a, you know, it's a run. You're giving, you know that you have to give, you're giving willingly, you're giving beforehand. And you're right, you could say giving before being asked publicly is the wrong, and then giving before being asked anonymously is a different wrong, if you wanted to break it up that way, although then you run out of eight, I think you might make some money. I'm not questioning Maimonides' reasoning fully in the way that he did, but it's an interesting question, you're right.
Yeah. Is there a sense of it's a good witness? If other people see you, they might be inspired or give the glory to God somehow?
Maybe, but the public here, there's a different, you know, publicly here by Maimonides is that you're giving, everybody knows you're giving, and somebody's receiving, and everybody knows exactly who it is who's receiving. Right. That's the problem there. One, you giving, if you're doing it so publicly, you're looking for some sort of accolade or recognition,
yeah,
which isn't necessarily in the interest of giving. At least you're giving, everybody's glad that you're giving, right? But that there is a certain sense that you're looking for some reward by people knowing that you're giving. And on the other hand, the other piece about publicly, very much so all throughout Talmud, is it's a sense of shame. You even said charity has a sense of degradation in some way, that people are needy and they shouldn't be needy. And so the highest level is to be totally anonymous and to make it in some way that you're helping somebody be self-sufficient, right? You don't know who's getting the money you're giving. They don't know who gave them the money, so they don't start treating you differently, or you feel like you may have some ownership over them, or whatever it is, totally anonymous giving. In fact, the highest mitzvah that you can do, not charity-wise, but in Judaism, the highest commandment, the highest mitzvah you can do is to go look after a cemetery, to go sweep up and make sure it's clean, that it's pretty, to take care of the leaves, because there's absolutely no way that the deceased people are going to give you any reward. You're doing it for yourself. You're doing it because it's the right, it's an obligation that's being given to you, and you're doing it solely because it needs to be done. And the only person who's really going to know that you're doing it is God, not the people who have died. So there's a sense that you're protecting somebody's honor by not shaming them and not pointing out that they happen to be needy. Right? I know that Imer has been waiting for a while for a question.
I was just going to quickly say, let's hope that the public part actually helps publicize and encourages others to do so.
Well, and we've known, you know, we've learned, unfortunately, even when you're doing a big capital campaign, we built synagogues and buildings, that people want their name up on a plaque nowadays. And you're going to get money for doing it, and so better to get the money and be able to serve the community in the way that you want to serve them. Rather than, oh no, we're not giving any recognition to anybody, so, you know, give or don't give, people don't, you know. So there's a balance here within modern society that we want, you know, that we want to be able to make sure with the money's it's important to have the charity.
But number four is the bronze plaque problem.
Right, number four is that bronze plaque. You want it to be up there.
Well, in our tradition, you know, we have, like I said before, don't do your charitable works in public where people can see it because you get the praise of men. But also in the Gospel of Matthew, it also says, let your light so shine before men that they might see your good works, right? But why? To then glorify God. Not to glorify you or praise you. So it has kind of that value to it, where it gives glory to God. Give a good example.
I want to say, because there is a, it seems that in Islam, it's a structure, it's a public structure, it's not left up to 101.5 million religions. Do that. No, it's almost parallel to the tax system, which means there is an organization that is central to collect it as well as central to distribute it. And that when you said eight categories, who receives that and who gives and who pays it and then who distributes it, that is not an easy task. Let's call that a vital map. Mm-hmm. And that vital map is a huge financial organization. It could be related to the church, it could be related to the religious leadership, it could be government, it could be any of that, but it is not left up to individuals or small groups, because this is in our society, let alone, it's very complex. Who's wanting what for what kind of cancer research and, I mean, amazing. This is not a subject to be, at this time now, to be left to individuals or to small groups. This is almost parallel to the tax system, and I don't know what you guys think of.
There is one thing, for the public, you know, we don't want to kill ourselves and actually punish ourselves, but if you give public, this is a shame on you. You know, sometimes, you know, you have to be the example for the people, okay? So this is why, you know, Islamically speaking, the best is to give concealing, you know, to the point. There are seven categories in the Day of Judgment that they will be shaded by God in a shade that nobody else is going to be shaded except them. Among them, a person that will give his charity with his right hand that his left hand does not know what the right has spent. Which you will find it, you know, in other religion, the same, you know, concept, the concealing. However, when you are actually, and I'm not, by the way, you know, I would not say I'm a Republican or Democrats or whatever, you know, but when you get a leader, you know, political leader, figure, he says, I will pay myself, you know, 50% of my income, okay? Even if he's showing up or not, God knows whether he's showing off or not, okay? But it can have an influence positively on the community. That others will start actually saying, you know what, one of the religious hospital based in Iowa, that they will say, there will be one day in our hospital that we will treat these poor people that they don't have health insurance, we'll treat them for free. By the way, they can actually claim these in their, you know, they can do that, okay? And they are cornered, some of them actually, that they are, guys, you are non-profit organizations, and you are taking all the money from the people, and you are not giving back anything to the community. So some of them, they say, you know what, we'll just, you know, write off something here and there, just like sprinkling, you know, on the brain.
Well, hospitals publicize what they have to write off.
As us, as community members, maybe, and I'm suggesting, you know, and I think that can be a project, you know, for all of us as community servants, not leaders, we can talk to some of these hospitals and get one of them to dedicate, you know, a number of hours or a day in a month to treat people for free. Give us that.
It's gonna be a long line.
But however, the point is, you know, you start the seed, and that can be publicly, you know, and you can encourage people, you know, this place is doing something good for whatever it is. You would start the action publicly. Yes, I would agree with these, you know, to have it. But number two, does it really matter? You want to serve the people.
Pastor Dave has a question.
I just comment, but, you know, Father, you referred to the charity in 1 Corinthians 13. And that agape word there means love that cannot be, you don't have to get a return for. It's not like eros or philia, which is a payback. But agape is something that they cannot pay back, or you do not expect return on. And so that fits into some of the Maimonides.
It certainly fits.
Things too, you know, of the things that you cannot be returned. So you're not expecting a return, or it doesn't, it happens.
Not done to get a result, or to get to receive it.
No.
May I interject a little bit with the story, like, you know, what you just mentioned? Indeed, when we are giving because we love God, because we want to be righteous. But Islamically speaking, there is, you know, a verse in the Holy Quran or a base for it. It says, if you do a good deed, at least God will give you 10 times of what you do. Okay? At least. You know, and it can be 700 times. It can be, you know, limitless of it. So there is a story that one of the companions of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he actually, you know, went to buy, and the whole thing in his house was equivalent to what he can buy an orange. And he went to the market to buy this orange to his wife. A needy person stopped him and he said, give me from what God has given you. He said, I cannot split it, just take it. So he took it, and as he went home, he told his wife about it, and Lord and behold, somebody knocking the door and saying, you know, there is a gift coming to you, and the gift was number of oranges. And as he's looking at it, you know, he counted, it was 9 of them. He said, where is number 10? He said, by God, this is number 10. But I wanted actually, and I hid it, I wanted to know from you, how did you know it's 10? He said, there is a verse in the Holy Quran, it says, if you do good deed, you will get at least 10. So it's by the, you know, and this is what religion actually helps. You can be a business person. There is no better deal to do than dealing with God. Okay? You stand in line, you know, in the Black Friday just to get, you know, buy one, get one free. So why don't you stand in front of God and you are not ashamed of it? Okay? So why we are ashamed of saying, yeah, I'll put it publicly. I'll give you 10 bucks because I need 100. Okay? But the 100 is not for me to actually go after you and say, I just gave it, you know, a few minutes ago and you are giving me 90. You should give me, you know, 100. Or charge people 100 because I must be getting it. This is, you know, where the basis of the religion and the concept helps people in actually looking after one another. Because I'm sure, you know, a day is going to become black on me, which is my right or white day, I helped somebody in black day. So a day is gonna come. If it doesn't come on me at all, I'm still going to be rewarded.
I think we're over time, but maybe one more question? One or two?
Three?
Wait.
I just wanted to echo a point. I wanted to echo a point that Imam has made a couple of times, and that is the usual data that is flung around about the same. About the degree of charitable giving in the U.S. are highly misleading. They might better be called civic mindedness or civic virtue, because only a tiny proportion of them really go to meet the needs of the poor. So they're often presented as though they were morally and politically and practically equivalent, but they're not.
Second, I think that for me, justice is intimately intertwined with political action. So my wife and I are very active in a Christian lobbying organization called Bread for the World, which is a lobby group on Capitol Hill. And when we get a bulletin saying that a piece of legislation is up for consideration that would cut 1% of the food stamp budget, and when we learn that that cut would be more of a cut than if all food pantries and all church feeding programs closed down tomorrow morning, that's a moral imperative for me to say, don't do that, because the consequences of that would be really dire. The other thing I wanted to mention is I rarely hear the concept of sacrificial giving used anymore. And my maternal, above my maternal grandparents' dinner table, where I spent every Sunday, was a painting of Jesus and the rich young ruler telling him, go sell all you have and give to the poor. And when my dad died 23 years ago, he gave me most of his diaries that he'd kept every day of his adult life, in which he very carefully recorded how much money he made, I think partly because he was a young man during the Great Depression and every penny mattered. But my siblings and I finally figured out that my father probably donated to what we might call charity, and it really was charity, about a third of his income from a very modest blue-collar income. And I look today, I succumb too easily to the sin of self-righteousness, but I look at the percentage of my colleagues at Co. who gave anything at all to United Way. I look at the amounts that my fellow parishioners at First Presbyterian Church give to the church, and I think they don't give it, few give any money in such a way that would get in their way of doing everything they want to in the rest of their lives. So where does the whole concept of sacrificial giving, of giving something up because you owe other people something, come into your three traditions?
There isn't a concept of sacrificial giving within Judaism. It's a very, it's a very 10%. It's not that, and in fact, Judaism, you shouldn't, if you're overly wealthy, it's not about, sacrificing what your needs are. You still need to be making, making your needs and meeting your family's needs, and even puts an upper limit, right? So we're not talking about giving till it hurts necessarily, although 10% for a lot of people would be a place where it really is hurting. And a lot of people don't even, I would venture to say that the vast majority don't even come close to approaching what would be really a 10%. Although if you factored everything in, charitable giving, also volunteer work and other things they do pro bono. Maybe. 10% is a lot. 10% is a lot. You're talking about really if you're working a 40-hour work week, adding 4 hours to give in some way every week, that is a sacrifice in some way. But it's not, Judaism is not a religion about suffering. the suffering Jew long ago, and it's not about suffering, it's about living life, right? It's about life. And so we shouldn't be doing our charity in such a way that is causing our own suffering either, although it's also about easing others.
Now the scripture that you mentioned, of course, summarizes, I think, the Christian perspective, if you would be perfect, Jesus says, one thing you still lack, if you follow the commandments to the T, you're lacking this, sell everything, give it to the poor, and then follow me. Very hard to do, involves going without, how to communicate, how to teach that. We tend to, during certain times of the year, before Easter, Great Lent, during fast, communicate that and teach people. We have a calendar that comes out, and every day, if they think about something, how much do you spend on coffee to meal every day? Set that aside and don't use it for that. Use it for something else to help somebody. Little ways like that. It's certainly there, and I think it's at the heart of the idea of love, going out of yourself to give to someone.
This is in my understanding of that that scripture, that story, is because the rich young ruler, however you want to refer to him, his wealth, his accumulation became his God. Mm-hmm. That was so important to him, he couldn't imagine
Yeah, he walked away very sad from that conversation.
Yes, he did. It's like, well, that's his story.
It's going to be different.
I'm getting up my audience.
Yeah. But with God, all things are possible, because who can go? Who can enter heaven, they ask. Well, it's possible.
The basic orientation, it seems to me, comes out of that story, is that a person's life is a life of service, and not of self-seeking. And to translate that into an institutional mode, if you think, somebody mentioned hospitals a little earlier, if when hospitals were places of service instead of centers for profit, our healthcare costs didn't escalate the way they do. So the whole orientation of our approach to life has taken a dramatic shift, and it's embodied in our fundamental institutions, where the whole idea is to make money, and that's what we're about.
Question, and this is something you touched on, Al. I have heard people, including my father, unfortunately, he's still alive, didn't really like to give, because he said, you don't know what those people are going to do with that money. If you give it to a food bank, and they'll get the card, and now they have the card instead of the food stamps, and then they'll buy booze with the cash they've got on hand. And I've always said, but I can't worry about those things.
No.
Where do these three great religions come down on that concept of giving and not worrying?
It's the attitude of the heart. The attitude of the heart. You give because you're asked, not because you're going to control what the person has or how they. Somebody asks you, you don't know, and you just let
right.
it go.
In Judaism, you give because it's an obligation. You're not worried about it. In fact,
mm-hmm.
the best giving is you don't even know who's getting it, right?
Yeah.
So you shouldn't be worrying about what the money goes to. Give to an organization that you trust. Give willingly.
Right.
Give a lot. Give what you can. But yeah, Judaism never puts emphasis on what the person does with the money. That your point, your role is to give. Right? That's your obligation. So live up to your obligation. And what the other people do, right?
Isn't it so that giving also can be in forms that are, in effect, directed, targeted, such as when you say the aid groups, in Islam, one of them is the people in debt. So you're paying off the debt. You're not going to give them here. You're giving them to pay the debt. So therefore, it's structured that it doesn't go just,
Sure.
Cans. He's worried about what they're doing with it. Don't give money. Go get canned food and give it to food banks. Right? Then it's obviously going out to the people that want food.
Somebody
right?
asks for money for
but
meal.
Really,
go
you
take
give.
Them, give them a meal.
Sorry.
Go take them lunch.
No. Most of the bankruptcy today, bankruptcy is declared as a result of medical expenses. So it's not food. People are not hungry.
Yeah.
That is in the society of,
right.
Abraham or it's not that. People declare bankruptcy because they can't afford the medical bills.
Let me touch on two quick things. The previous one about sacrifice. Islamically speaking, from Prophet Ibrahim, there is a saying in the Holy Quran, it says, "Qul inna salati wa nusuki wa mahyaya wa mamati lillahi rabbil alamin." Say, O Ibrahim, who is the father of everybody underneath him, coming after him, say, my prayer, my worship, my life, my death is for God. Meaning, all your life is sacrifice. One time, Prophet Muhammad, the example I give about the orange, that was the cousin of Prophet Muhammad and his son-in-law. Prophet Muhammad, with his wife, used to get, quite a bit of money, quite a bit of food, and he gives away these. One occasion, one time, he had quite a bit of money, and his wives asked him, this time, let us have a share, okay? And he said, there is no share for you. Everything is going out. So they got angry, Wives, they get angry, even wives of prophets, okay? So they got angry. There is a surah, a chapter was revealed, to all of them. Do you want this life? If you want this life, O Muhammad, divorce them and let them go have the best life they want. But if they want you, and they want God, and they want the hereafter, let them live and be the example of everybody else. So the sacrifice is there, yes, and you reach out. Now, The point of giving, you know, Brother Ayman was mentioning about, you need to search, you know, for who are you giving to, you know, and make sure that they are not going to be abusive. There is a verse in the Holy Quran, it says, don't give the people who are going to abuse what you will be giving them, even if it is their possession. If they own it, don't give it to them. Help them out in, if you are a relative, for example, or so. There is a wonderful story, I may be just sharing it in a minute. A person actually saw a dream that he has to give, you know, and he woke up in the morning and he said, okay, today I'm gonna give and make this day the best giving day for me. And he went and he found a lady in the street, you know, sitting, and he gave her a big bag of gold. That's at the time. And people, after he gave these, they looked at him and they said, are you stupid? This is a prostitute. Why did you give a prostitute money? You know, she's gonna be abusing it. And he went home very sad. Saw a dream that he must be giving. So he, next day, he said, I'm gonna do a better decision. He found somebody, you know, standing in a corner. He thought, this is, you know, a decent guy, he's a poor guy. So he gave him the money, the people that, you know, came to him, and they said, you know, who's this guy that you gave him? He's the biggest thief. The following day, I said, I'm not gonna give any lady sitting, you know, nobody in the corner. And he found somebody, you know, in a group, and then he gave him a big bag of another gold, and they told him, you know what? This is the richest guy in the whole city. At night, as he's sleeping, a dream came to him, and somebody told him, you know what did you do to this prostitute? When she found out that she's selling her honesty and her honor for money, and she found somebody caring for her to give her these without her going out and endangering herself, she stopped the prostitute. And the thief, when he found that, he's actually putting himself and others in danger to steal from them. He's not going to steal anymore, and he decided to repent and being better. And the guy that you give him, and he was the richest, he was the most stingy person in town. And when he found somebody, you know, less fortunate than him, and you give him, he gave all his wealth in the second place. So back to the point, you know, you give, you try your best, you know, and if you screw it up, you get the reward still, because you try
again. Right. And you never know how it will affect somebody else's life. You never know how it will affect somebody else. You might assume that they're going to waste it, but you never know what they're going to do with it. So you do what's right for you and right for your society, and trust that other people will do their own thing.
I'm glad that it's all confirmed and corroborated.
Charity is an easy topic.
You did a great job. Thank you very much.